You come up thousands of miles coming through Mexico, and we're going to stop it. Get them out of here. Get them out of here. Go home to your mom, darling. Go home.
Jeffrey Epstein, bad man. And Trump, bad man, because Trump and Jeffrey Epstein are in this picture together, and this is terrible because this guy's a pedophilic rapist, you know, or something like that, right?
Does Donald Trump just happen to be in a photograph of Jeffrey Epstein, or is there actually a connection here? In 2002, Trump told New York Magazine, "I've known Jeff for 15 years, terrific guy. He's a lot of fun to be with. It is even said that he likes beautiful women as much as I do, and many of them are on the younger side. No doubt about it, Jeffrey enjoys the social life." Epstein is a convicted child sex trafficker. His Palm Beach home was raided in 2005. Some of the photographs found in his home were so bad that authorities had to blur them out in the video. This one featured a child no more than 7 years old, bending over in a tiny dress. Even more interesting, video cameras were found hidden in clocks, and it's believed that he used those cameras to tape his famous friends in sex acts with underage girls for blackmail purposes. One of his victims, Virginia Roberts, said, "Epstein required me to describe the sexual events that I had with these men, presumably so that he could potentially blackmail them. I'm still very fearful of these men today." So who is Epstein running these honey traps for? Well, his best friend Ghislaine Maxwell was also involved. She was the one who recruited the young girls at Trump's Mar-a-Lago. And her father was Robert Maxwell, one of the most famous Israeli spies. He is well known for Promise Software, a program that Israeli intelligence stole, reconstructed with a backdoor, then sold to banks and intelligence agencies all over the world. Israel then had the ability to see everything important that was going on. They also sold it to the Sandia Nuclear Development Laboratory, stealing some of the most sensitive US secrets. It was Maxwell who was able to market it and sell it so successfully. Former Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir said that no one had done more for the state of Israel than Robert Maxwell. Maxwell actually reminds me of Donald Trump, who Yair Netanyahu recently said is the best friend Jews ever had. Maxwell also had deep ties to organized crime. He was the one who helped get top Jewish mob boss Semyon Mogilevich an Israeli passport. Mogilevich was on the FBI's 10 most wanted list and is now living in Russia. He owns pipelines, he's into arms dealing, child trafficking, you name it. His name has come up a lot after Trump was elected. Former senior advisor to Donald Trump, Felix Sater, is a two-time convicted felon whose father worked for Mogilevich. Sater was also the managing director of Bayrock Group and developed Trump Soho. He's being investigated for using Soho to launder millions of dollars.
If he were sitting in the room right now, I really wouldn't know what he looked like. Mm-hmm.
Trump and Maxwell have a lot in common. They're both in bed with the Jewish mob, they've both done so much for the state of Israel, and they both bought Khashoggi's yachts. Adnan Khashoggi is a part Jewish Saudi arms dealer. He was also a Mossad agent. He was outed by Viktor Ostrovsky in his book, By Way of Deception. Let's take a look at how close Trump's inner circle is to Jeffrey Epstein. Back in 2018, Trump's former chief strategist, Stephen Bannon, was spotted stepping out of his SUV and entering the registered sex offender's mansion in Manhattan. Trump's Secretary of Commerce, Wilbur Ross, was at a movie screening with Epstein just 2 months after his release from what was basically house arrest. Ross is the former managing director of Rothschild Inc., who bailed out Trump in the 90s. U.S. Attorney Alex Acosta violated the Federal Crime Victims Rights Act and signed off on the non-prosecution agreement without notifying the women. He then gave Epstein a truly sweetheart deal, where he only had to serve 13 months in county jail, while being allowed to go home for another 12 hours of the day. Despite this, Trump chose Acosta to be his labor secretary. Acosta has recently resigned due to pressure. I'm sure you've all heard of the Lolita Express, Epstein's private plane where him and Ghislaine are accused of organizing underage sex parties. There's also a rumor that Trump kicked Epstein out of the Mar-a-Lago. Let's try to verify that.
I've heard the rumor that Epstein was kicked out of there for allegedly trying to pick up somebody's daughter or something like that, but I think I did chase that down as far as I could and never was able to confirm it, but I heard it.
So, Trump didn't actually ban Epstein from Mar-a-Lago, and Epstein's phone directory from his computer contains 14 numbers for Donald Trump, including emergency numbers, car numbers, and numbers to Trump's security guard and houseman. Jeffrey Epstein's brother, Mark, testified that Trump flew on Jeffrey's plane with him.
But when we do talk about Jeffrey Epstein, there isn't really too much of a connection between him and Trump if you compare it to Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton, their buddy, right? Bill Clinton, their pal.
Both Trump and Clinton were on the Lolita Express. A lot of the alt media doesn't want to admit this and will try to say that only Bill Clinton is a sexual deviant, while Trump is a moral man.
You know, I'm automatically attracted to beautiful. I just start kissing them. It's like a magnet. You just kiss. I don't even wait. And when you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything.
Whatever you want.
Grab them by the pussy. I can do anything.
Pull the hell.
Hello, how are you?
I'm sure there's going to be a few people who think that I'm jumping the gun on Vince and James. Well, let's take a look at this. On his own website, he says that Trump is turning on Israel and is exposing their role in 9/11. Now ask yourself, is Vince retarded or is he lying to you?
And Donald Trump says, quote, elect me and you'll find out who really knocked down the Twin Towers. He's saying, elect me and I will expose 9/11. They may go ahead and kill him. I mean, you need to pray for Donald Trump right now, folks. And by the way, we need your prayers.
When the FBI arrested all those Israelis in 2001, did that mean Bush was exposing Israel? No. For the past couple years, when the FBI was investigating and arresting Trump's team, most of the alt media said that the FBI was working for a mysterious deep state. Now, when the FBI does something good, like declassifying 9/11 documents or arresting Jeffrey Epstein, most of the alt media says that the FBI is working for Trump.
And his DOJ just took him down. So I don't know how they can be saying that Trump is supporting this guy, this, that, and the other, when it was his DOJ that just took him down.
It was the Southern District of New York's Public Corruption Unit that decided to go after Epstein. You know what? Let's take a look at Trump's DOJ. Attorney General William Barr, who initially decided to recuse himself from the case, said, "I am recused from that matter because one of the law firms that represented Epstein long ago was a firm that I subsequently joined for a period of time." Kirkland & Ellis, the law firm in question, represented Epstein when he agreed to the infamous plea deal in 2008. It's possible Mr. Barr would attempt to interfere in the case, former FBI Assistant Director Frank Figliuzzi said before Mr. Barr's refusal, noting that the Attorney General's father, Donald Barr, hired Epstein as a teacher at a school in New York in the 1970s.
Good news on the Trump front. I did a video recently about why I still support Trump, because he goes after PEDOs. My family's over there. Jeffrey Epstein has been arrested, faces 40 years in prison.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Amy, are you excited?
Yeah, that's
great news. Okay, so I know the despair people will come in and say,
Here are six people in Trump's inner circle who have ties to Epstein. What's Alan Dershowitz's relationship with Trump? Dershowitz, who's affiliated with Chabad Lubavitch, got Trump to release Rabbi Shalom Rubashkin from prison. A former federal prosecutor said, "It makes no sense that Donald Trump chose to commute the sentence of former agriprocessor's executive officer, Shalom Rubashkin, who the prosecutor called one of the biggest employers of illegal immigrants." Testimony showed Rubashkin and his team helped hundreds of illegal immigrants acquire false documents. During the raid, feds also found a meth lab operating at the slaughterhouse. Trump talks tough about Mexicans bringing drugs across the border, and rightfully so. But when Jewish mobsters flood the streets in America with meth, he releases them from prison. The female workers also complained that the supervisors would rape them in the storage room at the plant, and there was also children working there. Rubashkin systematically frauded banks, causing more than $26 million in losses. He then laundered the money through charitable organizations. The world's foremost expert on slaughter methods, Dr. Temple Grandin, told Mason City, Iowa's Globe Gazette, "I thought it was the most disgusting thing I'd ever seen. I couldn't believe it. I've been in at least 30 kosher slaughter plants, and I had never, ever seen that kind of procedure done before. This place was literally hell on earth. They would electrocute the cattle, rape the goyim, cook meth, steal tens of millions of dollars, and Dershowitz got Trump to set Rubashkin free."
Well, this is
I've
what,
gotten
this is...
guilty people acquitted of murder.
Dershowitz is a mob lawyer. Let's take a look at other Jewish mobsters he's defended. Israeli billionaire Benny Steinmetz is suspected of paying tens of millions of dollars to Guinea President Alpha Conde and his wife as a bribe for the granting of iron mining licenses in Guinea. The Israeli police said, "The evidence and the development of the investigation indicate that the benefit Steinmetz is suspected of having obtained through bribery amounts to $5 billion. He's also suspected of money laundering." Dershowitz also defended another Israeli billionaire, Dan Gertler, who amassed his fortune through hundreds of millions of dollars worth of corrupt mining and oil deals in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Gertler has used his close friendship with DRC President Joseph Kabila to act as a middleman for mining asset sales in the DRC, requiring some multinational companies to go through Gertler to do business with the Congolese state. As a result, between 2010 and 2012 alone, the DRC reportedly lost over $1.36 billion in revenues from the underpricing of mining assets. Just like how Israel bribes politicians in America to get billions of dollars every year, they also bribe politicians in Africa, making billions of dollars exploiting the natural resources, arming both sides of a war, then millions of Africans end up fleeing to Europe. Dershowitz is a Mossad asset. One of his jobs is to put out Israeli propaganda claiming that Palestinians die because Hamas is using them as human shields.
The Israeli army has been accused of using Palestinians, including children, as human shields during an operation in the West Bank. One case caught on camera by an Israeli human rights group appears to show Israeli soldiers forcing a Palestinian to go with them as they searched house to house in the West Bank town of Nablus. Another alleged victim who spoke to the BBC was just 11 years old.
"They had their weapons pointed at me. I was so afraid that the soldiers might do what they threatened, take me to jail or shoot me."
"I want to ask you, are these men being detained?"
"Yes."
You can't use them as human shields. This is a war crime. You know that, right?
"Not as a human shield. We
They're standing in front of your Jeep. That's not a human shield? How is that not?
ولد صغير من دار ربيع استنى صوره سلام عشان ماسكينه الدلع سلام
What the fuck?
Palestinians just want people to accept their very simple demands. And those demands are that every Jew and Christian be murdered according to the Quran. Oh, sweet Palestine.
Now, let's look into what Palm Beach Police Chief Michael Rader and Detective Joseph Ricari had to say about this case. Word got back to Epstein that some of the girls had been questioned by police. Epstein then hired Alan Dershowitz. Alan Dershowitz flew down and met privately with Palm Beach State Attorney Barry Krischer, Ricari said. And the shenanigans that happened? I don't think I've ever seen or heard of before. Krischer began to dodge Ricari and Rader's phone calls and emails, and they dragged their feet on approving subpoenas. Early on, it became clear that things had changed, from Krischer saying, "We'll put this guy away for life," to, "These are all the reasons why we aren't going to prosecute this," Rader said.
The U.S. Attorney's Office got involved with this case with Jeffrey Epstein's A-list of defense attorneys that are extremely well known and extremely powerful. I think these attorneys were able to manipulate the sitting U.S. attorney and the assistant U.S. attorney working the cases. A few things happened in this case that during my law enforcement career I've never seen before. The U.S. attorneys here had an indictment and they were sending it back and forth to Jeffrey's lawyers for changes. Never seen anything like that before.
Epstein hired somebody that would impress the state attorney, Barry Krischer, to drop the investigation.
It became apparent to me that some of our evidence was being leaked to Epstein's lawyers, who began to question everything that we had in our probable cause affidavit, Rader said. The day of the search, on October 20, 2005, they found that most of Epstein's computer hard drives, surveillance cameras, and videos had been removed from the house, leaving loose, dangling wires, according to the police report. Dershowitz wrote in a letter to Ricari, "Our investigation had discovered at least one of her websites, and I am enclosing some examples. The site goes on to detail, including photos, her apparent fascination with marijuana." Ricari responded, "His attorney showed us a MySpace page where one of the girls was holding a beer in her hand, and they said, 'Oh look, she is underage drinking.'" Well, tell me what teenager doesn't. Does that mean she isn't a victim because she drank a beer? Basically, what you're telling me is, the only victim of sexual battery could be a nun. According to Dershowitz, we shouldn't take the girls seriously because they smoked weed or drank beer. But then why should we believe Dershowitz when he's the one getting guilty people acquitted of murder?
Well, this is
guilty people acquitted of murder.
Mm-hmm. They had a very weak case. They had to rely on the word of witnesses who had long records of lying.
In May 2006, Rader wrote a letter which was released to the news media, calling on Krischer to remove himself from the case. Rader, Ricari, and the victims were being stalked by private investigators, who were most likely Mossad. Ricari just happened to die at a fairly young age. Kenneth Starr, who Epstein hired to defend him against charges that he sexually abused girls, was also the one who uncovered Bill Clinton's sexual relationship with Monica Lewinsky. In March 1999, British author Gordon Thomas released a book, Gideon Spies, which alleged that Israel had blackmailed the Clinton administration with the threat to release tapped telephone conversations between the president and Monica Lewinsky to force Washington to abandon the mega hunt. In her testimony before independent counsel Kenneth Starr, Lewinsky said that the president had warned her on March 29, 1997, at the height of the mega hunt, that he suspected the White House telephones were being tapped by agents of an unnamed foreign country. And U.S. intelligence officials suspect Bibi Netanyahu of activating MEGA, the Israeli spy ring. Clinton basically admitted that Bibi blackmailed him. He said, "Bibi knows how to hit people where they're tender."
I was young, I was scared, I knew these people were powerful. I didn't know what would happen if I said no. I didn't know what would happen if I reported them. That 16-year-old girl just let it happen. And that was how I got into the beast with Jeffrey and Gillen.
Virginia Roberts was working in the spa at Donald Trump's Mar-a-Lago Club in Palm Beach when British socialite Ghislaine Maxwell introduced her to multimillionaire Jeffrey Epstein.
The training started immediately. I mean, it was everything down to how to give a blowjob, how to be quiet, be subservient, give Jeffrey what he wants. A lot of this training came from Ghislaine herself. And being a woman, it kind of surprises you that a woman could actually let stuff like that happen, but not only let it happen, but to groom you into doing it. And then there's Jeffrey, who's telling you, "I want it this way, no, go slower, and don't do that, and do this." You're just thrown into a world that you don't understand, and you're screaming on the inside and you don't know how to let it come out, and you just become this numb figure who refuses to feel and refuses to speak and refuses, all you do is obey, that's it. And eventually it led to, well, now we're gonna experiment and we're gonna try you with another guy and see how you go. So they sent me to an island with a professor, and I basically had to do what I did for Jeffrey for him. So it's very private. It's the perfect world for a billionaire getting away with what he was doing. He could hold big parties there and have huge orgies there, and nobody would have any idea what was going on because it was so quiet and so protected. And it started with one, and then it trickled into two, and then so on and so forth. And, you know, before you know it, I'm being lent out to politicians and to academics and to people that you, royalty.
Roberts claimed in an affidavit the two of the men that Epstein lent her out to were attorney Alan Dershowitz and Prince Andrew, the Duke of York.
There's another girl who backs up Virginia Roberts' claims about Dershowitz. Maria Farmer, now 49, worked in Epstein's apartment acquiring artwork, and she said she saw numerous young girls come to the house, some of them still wearing their school uniforms. She also saw Dershowitz there and said that he would go upstairs where the girls were led. Epstein arranged for Farmer to work on an art project at the Ohio mansion of his friend, Israeli billionaire Leslie Wexner. At one point, Epstein and Maxwell came for a visit and sexually assaulted Farmer, she says in the affidavit. MEGA, the Israeli spy ring, was founded in 1991 by Wexner. There's not much evidence indicating where Epstein got his wealth from. The bulk of Epstein's wealth is believed to come from his money management firm for 10-figure investors, although his only known client is Victoria's Secret founder, Les Wexner. Executive suit financiers discussed how absent Epstein was from the field. He's supposed to run an enormous FX trading firm, said Enrique Diaz Alvarez, chief risk officer at Ebury. But I never once heard of him or his firm or anyone who worked or traded with him. And as Forbes wrote in a 2010 blog post with a very direct title, sex offender Jeffrey Epstein is not a billionaire. His money management firm based in the U.S. Virgin Islands generates no public records, nor has his client list ever been released. But even the real estate holdings have an air of mystery to them. Epstein purchased or received the Manhattan townhouse from Wexner around 1998, but there were no property records on the mansion's transfer until 2011, when the company Wexner used to buy the place transferred it to an Epstein-owned company for $0. Epstein signed the document for both sides. Les Wexner founded Mega, the Israeli spy ring. Wexner was a Mossad agent who financed Epstein to run the sexual blackmail operation.
My daughter serves in the Mossad, Mr. Godman. Do you know what their motto is? By deception, we will do war.
The other person who founded Mega was Jewish mobster Charles Bronfman, owner of Seagram's, whose family made their fortune from Prohibition.
If you take a look at Prohibition, which was in the 20s, 50% of the leading bootleggers, not the guys who are making some gin in their bathtub, but the leading ones, you know, the top men, half of them were Jewish.
The Israeli media describes Charles Bronfman as a foreign donor who reshaped Israel. He also founded Birthright alongside casino mogul and Jewish mob boss Sheldon Adelson, who is Trump's biggest financier. CBC calls Adelson the godfather. He finances Trump and Israeli dictator Bibi Netanyahu. He also financed former Canadian Prime Minister Stephen Harper. In May 2001, a mega group meeting took place at the Manhattan mansion of Edgar Bronfman Sr., Charles's brother, who also donated many times to Israel. He served as the president of the World Jewish Congress, where he is remembered for helping bring Soviet Jews to Israel, just like Robert Maxwell did. His son, Edgar Bronfman Jr., former chairman of Warner Music Group, is also in Jeffrey Epstein's Little Black Book. And his sister, Claire Bronfman, recently pleaded guilty in the NXIVM case, admitting she held sex slaves. She faces 25 years, but it looks like she'll only serve 21 months. And Roger Stone, Trump's former advisor, was also a lobbyist for NXIVM. Now, we'll look at Trump's mentor, Roy Cohn, who was also a pedophile.
Poor Roger, with fond memories and the highest regard and affection for his good work in the 1980 campaign from a good friend, Roy Cohn.
Roger Stone, who idolized Roy Cohn, said, "Roy was not gay. He was a man who liked having sex with men. Gays were weak, effeminate. He always seemed to have these young blonde boys around. It just wasn't discussed. He was interested in power and access." Roy Cohn's own cousin, David Marcus, said, "Donald fit the pattern of the hangers-on and the disciples around Roy. He was tall and blonde and, frankly, uber-Gentile. Something about Roy's self-hating Jewish persona drove him to fair-haired boys. And at these parties, there was a bevy of blonde guys, almost Midwestern, and Donald Trump was paying homage to Roy. I wondered then if Roy was attracted to him." I could elaborate more on Roy Cohn and Roger Stone, but they deserve their own episode, and I'll make it if I'm still alive. Another pedophile in Trump's inner circle is Tafiq Arif, founder of Bayrock Group, who developed Trump Soho with Felix Sater. Both Sater and Arif are affiliated with Chabad Lubavitch. Arif is also dubbed David by his people. Arif and Jewish oligarch Alexander Moshkevich were arrested on a yacht in Turkey with prostitutes as young as 13 years old. Moshkevich leased the yacht, and Arif provided the girls. The women were told by their leaders not to speak or testify. The Turkish police suggested they get help from the Russian embassy, contact a Russian-speaking lawyer or their families, but they refused. "Don't testify, any of you," said a text message they received. "Everything is falling apart. Don't sign anything. They are out of control and have no power. You will soon be home."
No, don't worry. I don't expect you to do anything you don't want to do. Just talk to them, listen to what they have to say, and then we will send you home.
Alexander Moshkevich, founder of the Eurasian Jewish Congress, owns privatized and natural resources in Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and Africa. He's also a major donor to the State of Israel. One of his entourage describes him as an enthusiastic Jew and Zionist. He also donates significantly for synagogue construction in Russia. Trump is deep in bed with the mob, and many of his friends have 13-year-old Ukrainian and Russian prostitutes trapped in Israel. This is a big part of the mob's business, and it's a multi-billion dollar industry in Israel that Trump turns a blind eye to.
A large number of the Russian oligarchs were Jewish, so they could therefore get an Israeli passport. And the Israeli banking system, indeed the Israeli system as a whole, is designed to encourage immigration by Jews from the outside. But Israel had never seen anything like the immigration between 1990 and 2000 of Russians into Israel. About 1 million of them, that's 15% of Israel's population. And the police force in Israel, which is, you know, its resources tend to be devoted towards the Palestinian issue, had no idea what was going on when these Russians came in. They brought in a lot of money, which they used Israeli banks to launder it through, and they brought in some of their organized crime entourages. And Israel, which was also beginning to feel the impact of globalization, became an important area of organized crime in the region. At the same time, I mean, I have to say that this is, if, for example, it's become one of the main countries that receives trafficked women for prostitution from all over the world, although largely from the former Soviet Union.
Trump also donated to Chabad Lubavitch, a messianic ultra-Orthodox organization where pedophilia is rampant. Remember Shalom Rubashkin, who Trump released from prison? Well, his son-in-law, Chabad Rabbi Yaakov Weiss, pleaded guilty to sexually molesting two boys as young as 13. And he told one of the boys to lie to their mother about what happened. For decades, Jewish boys were being raped by Chabad rabbis, and now they are speaking out. The Australian Chabad community has faced accusations of letting or even helping child molestation suspects get out of the country and into Israel or the US instead of turning them over to law enforcement authorities. Not only do these men escape punishment, but they are then capable of abusing new victims. Chabad operates in the US, and for that matter, all over the world. But it forms a nearly inescapable network in Australian Jewish life, according to Wax. As hard as it is for victims of sexual abuse to ever come forward, Wax believes it is even harder for Australian Jews because of Chabad's strength. In Australia, the Chabad community dominates the rabbinic scene. The vast majority of rabbis serving the country are from Chabad. The yeshivas are connected through Chabad. If you go up against an individual rabbi, you're up against the entire system, Wax said. I'll show you more examples where Chabad rabbis downplay pedophilia. Here's Rabbi Baruch Lachez, who now heads the Lubavitch community in Monsey, New York, and was the top leader at Sydney Chabad for 20 years. In recordings of a recent phone conversation with an individual familiar with child sex allegations against Sydney's Chabad community in the 1980s, Lachez said, "We are speaking about very young boys. Everybody says about the other one that he agreed to this." Chabad Rabbi Manus Friedman compared being molested as a child to having diarrhea. He said, "Do I have to tell my girlfriend that I was molested? Do you have to tell that you once had diarrhea? It's embarrassing, but nobody's business." The Royal Commission asked Chabad Rabbi Yosef Feldman, "Did you understand that it was against the law for an adult to touch the genitals of another child?" "I didn't know that as a fact," he responded. And he was the director of the Yeshiva Corporation and ran a school for decades. Most of the mobsters I've shown in this video are affiliated with Chabad, and they're going to continue to get away with abusing children while Trump is in power. Trump has been surrounded by pedophiles since him and Roger Stone were disciples of Roy Cohn. They didn't do anything about his pedophilia because he made them rich. Yes, pedophiles have been arrested by Trump's DOJ. Every year, pedophiles get caught and arrested, no matter who's president. It's the ones who are tied to organized crime that will remain untouched, unless there's massive public pressure a la Jeffrey Epstein. This narrative that Trump is purging the pedophiles and is going to save the world comes from Zionist disinfo agents, SGT Report and QAnon.
On March 10th, Q also posted this photo of Vatican priests and Nazis calling the New World Order the Nazi Order, and Q's use of the words "sum of all fears" calls to mind the 1991 book by Tom Clancy, which was released days before the August 1991 coup, which signaled the dissolution of the Soviet Union. The 2002 film of the same name was about a neo-Nazi plot to trigger a nuclear war between the United States and Russia. Put the pieces of the puzzle together.
I know some of you are thinking, how can this or that person be a shill if they're calling out the Jews? They do that to draw you in. And once they have that audience's attention, they start shilling for Trump. They are working in the best interest of their tribe.
My mother was born in Berlin in 1937. To a pretty Jewish clan, and this was, of course, pretty much the worst time you could pick to be born, and you know, the culture you could choose to be born in.
On my mother's side, there's a lot more, I guess, Jewish influence or Jewish history, as far as I understand it. My grandmother was Jewish, which I've also been told makes me Jewish, though I could give
The question of ethnicity and IQ is a whole layer cake. You know, just very briefly, the very top, the Ashkenazi Jews, this is the Jews that are the wandering Jews, so to speak. The Ashkenazi Jews.
You're sitting across from an Ashkenazi Jew. Can you feel the IQ?
I actually am trying to hoover up some language skills from you. I'll do it later with a straw. But
I've been dumbing it down for you. So
I know,
there you go.
And I appreciate as a Caucasian, I really need to go slow.
Yeah.
I love lots of subtitles, hand puppets help as well.
Every part of my bloodline has been here for the run, even the Jewish part. And they were right wing. Now that I look into it, they were bankers from the Czech Republic and very free market people.
Can't wait.
Like, is my kid white? I don't even know.
Your kid is definitely not white.
Well,
you're half Jewish and your kid's half Mexican.
Yes.
So wait, can I smoke this in here, by the way?
Yeah, sure.
So I was like, well, call out Netanyahu. I don't know much about Netanyahu because I'm not a Jew. I don't know.
Bibi wants to be president of the United States for another 4 years. He needs the alternative media to portray Trump as the savior, even if they have to dog whistle to get your attention. The end more than justifies the means.
I don't really honestly deep down believe in political action. I think the system contracts and expands as it wants to. It accommodates these changes. I think the civil rights movement was an accommodation on the part of those who own the country. I think they see where their self-interest lies. They see a certain amount of freedom seems good, an illusion of liberty. Give these people a voting day every year so that they'll have the illusion of meaningless choice. Meaningless choice that we go like slaves and say, "Yo, I voted." The limits of debate in this country are established before the debate even begins, and everyone else is marginalized. They're made to seem either to be communists or some sort of disloyal person, a kook, there's a word, and now it's conspiracy. See, they've made that something that should not be even entertained for a minute, that powerful people might get together and have a plan. Doesn't happen. You're a kook. You're a conspiracy buff. So, the only way you cure that, death, bloodshed. I don't advocate it, but I see that it's really the only answer. And even if I could, I wouldn't turn on you. And I would stop the road for you. You know I wanna let you know. I'll never let this feeling go. This love has no ceiling. I cannot deny. Even if I could, I wouldn't turn on you.
Jeffrey Epstein knew that I was 13 years old. When he interviewed me, he asked me to get down to my bra and my panties. And I thought that was weird, but I mean, modeling, maybe it was something about my figure. And he asked that I give him a massage. And then he asked me my age. He asked me, and I told him, told him that I was 13. I told him why I was there. And he basically said, "Well, you'll do. You know, I'm sure that you'll fit pretty nicely here." And then he tried to slip himself inside of me, and I pushed him away, and I said, "You know, I'm because at that point in time, I still believed that there was models, and then there was the girls that did that. Like, I thought there was a separation. So, I told him that I wasn't interested in that, but he said that I would do. I don't know. There was something about him that I guess I kind of held him, I held a lot of resentment towards him. By that time that happened, I kind of already started catching on that maybe I wasn't there for modeling and maybe I was just getting used for things, and I felt that I kind of held him responsible. The first time that I met Donald Trump was at a party at Jeffrey Epstein's mansion. There was an orgy going on, and he was kind of watching off in the distance. And he basically asked if I could come over and give him a hand job. And at first, I wasn't very comfortable with it. This was like my first or second, first party, and I didn't think that was my responsibility. But my recruiter told me that I needed to do it, so I agreed to. And then he, sorry, this is a little difficult, but. Before I gave him a hand job, he kind of slapped my hand away and said, "You need to use a glove." And the recruiter ran over and handed me a glove and said, "No one touches Mr. Trump's penis without a glove." So I needed to use a glove. I gave him a hand job, and then immediately after, he had an orgasm, he left, and I didn't see him again at that party.
And unprotected sex, et cetera. So, and you know, he's germaphobe. I mean, Donald Trump wouldn't shake your hand. He does it now because he has to as a candidate or a president. But back in the 70s and 80s, if he went to shake Donald Trump's hand, he would pull it back. Mm. He wouldn't, and he would always have the hand wash with him, you know, to wash his hands.
Donald Trump knew that I was 13 because the first night that I was there, Tiffany actually suggested that, and she had a whole bunch of different wigs, and I expressed interest in them. You know, I always told her that I would love to walk around with blue hair, and so I tried some on, and there was a blonde wig that she said that looked great on me. So I wore that wig, and Donald Trump had specifically asked about me because I remind him of his daughter, and she said, well, she's 13 as well. So he knew the first time that he saw me, but he took a liking to me because I look like his daughter. There wasn't, out of all the girls that were there with me, most of them were 13, 14. I think the oldest one might have been 16, just turned 16. And she'd been there for a while. Second time that I saw Mr. Trump was same scenario. He was onlooking at an orgy, and Tiffany came over to me and said that Donald Trump had requested that I perform oral sex on him. I'd never done something like that with anybody, so I was a little nervous. So I walked up to him, and he was sitting there very proud, like, and I just kind of moved in that direction, and he kind of slapped me away and said, "What are you doing? You know, you need to put a condom on." Like I was some like dirty filth or something without a condom. Tiffany ran over and handed him a condom and apologized, you know, profusely, and said that would never happen again. And she looked at me and scolded me basically like a child and said that, you know, that's not how, you know, Donald Trump always, you know, anytime you touch his penis, it needs to have a condom on or a glove, you know, and especially when it comes to performing oral sex. So I apologized, and then I performed oral sex on him. And once again, once he was done, he hopped up, and that's the last I saw of him at that party. It's like, once he's done, he's out. So.
Okay.
The only time that that he tried to give me some money was our last encounter together, where he acted out a rape fantasy. I was forced to give that money back because Jeffrey Epstein paid us after the party, so. But he just gave me the money. I don't even know why he gave it to me, maybe to make me feel more cheap, but it was a rape fantasy to him, but I wasn't playing. So there was a lot of comments towards Mr. Epstein about, you know, being Jewish, and, you know, called him a Jew bastard, you know, so that he was cheap. And there were some words I didn't even understand, something about the shape of his penis being directly related to his mole, or, I mean, I'm not too familiar with the Jewish tradition. So after the parties would end, we were to report to Mr. Epstein and basically tell him everything that happened, with who, what they liked, what they disliked, if there was any requests, if there was any talk about anything. That's what, you know, we told Mr. Epstein everything. And then he paid us, and then we got to go home.
It It's not just Virginia Roberts saying the same things as Katie Johnson. In 2018, Stormy Daniels also said Trump told her that she reminded him of his daughter before sex. And Trump's lawyer at the time, Michael Cohen, admitted that they paid Stormy Daniels $130,000 to try and shut her up.
I was involved in several of these catch and kill episodes. He asked me to pay off an adult film star with whom he had an affair. He was concerned with the effect that it had had on the campaign. He had told me that he had spoken to a couple of friends, and it's $130,000. It's not a lot of money, and we should just do it.
Harvey, he liked Trump. Michael liked Trump, but he don't like him enough to go through that time for him. He ain't from the neighborhood.
And that's the big question. How much time could Michael Cohen face? Since we were quoting I'm a Hustler, I'm going to go ahead and put it on again. The big issue here is the Bank Fraud Act, which could carry up to 30 years in prison for Cohen. That's a lot of pressure.
I have to agree with 50. Cohen likes Trump, but not enough to do 30 years for him. He flipped and got a deal where he only has to serve 3 years in a luxurious Jewish prison in New York, where he has all the food he wants, synagogue services, and he's surrounded by his fellow Jewish mobsters, so he has no fear for his safety, as most prisoners would.
You know, when you think of prison, you get pictures in your mind of all those old movies with rows and rows of guys behind bars. But it wasn't like that for wise guys. It really wasn't that bad, except that I missed Jimmy. He was doing his time in Atlanta.
Give me two steaks while you're in there, all right, John? Sure enough, she goes in
a... I mean, everybody else in the joint was doing real time, all mixed together, living like pigs. But we lived alone. I mean, we owned the joint.
Well, batted them two son of a bitches.
The Jerusalem Post listed Cohen as the 14th most influential Jew. He was Trump's consigliere, his right-hand man, just like Silvio was to Tony in The Sopranos. Within the Trump organization, he's known as Trump's pitbull, and that's really the best way to explain what he was doing for Trump.
You write a story that has Mr. Trump's name in it with the word race, and I'm going to mess your life up for the rest of it. The more you do on this freaking planet, I'm going to turn around, you're going to have judgments against you for so much money, you'll never know how to get out from underneath it.
Michael,
I was 24 freaking years old. You want to destroy your life? Then it will be my privilege to serve it to you on a freaking silver platter. Like I did that idiot from Pennsylvania to Miss USA because I think she's dumber than she is.
Cohen is a mob lawyer, and after he flipped, Trump threatened to go after his father-in-law, Fema Schusserman, who has ties to organized crime. Maria Zakharova, the Russian Foreign Ministry spokeswoman, said on television that Jewish donors told her, Maroka, you understand, of course, we'll donate to Clinton, but we'll donate twice as much to the Republicans. She then told the audience that if you want to know anything, you need to talk to the residents of Brighton Beach, a New York neighborhood with a large Russian Jewish community.
Not once in that stock scan were there any Russian organized crime figures. Except my dad was involved with the Russian mob.
So you say nonchalantly, my dad was in the Russian mob.
Yes.
Okay, so what's the Russian mob? I mean, we don't...
Like every generation, every immigrant group that comes here, they're insular. They don't go... They sort of stay to themselves. Gambling, your basic run-of-the-mill racketeering.
In the 70s, Russian Jews began leaving the Soviet Union and settled in Brooklyn's Brighton Beach. A lot of them brought their skills from the old country, and Brighton Beach is now well known as a hotbed for Russian organized crime. Jewish mobster Boris Neyfeld served as a bodyguard and chauffeur for the don of the Russian mob, Murat Balagula. Balagula maintained an office at the El Karib Country Club, a Brooklyn catering hall and event space owned by Michael Cohen's uncle, Morton Levine. Cohen and his family are involved with organized crime. Cohen received $500,000 from Russian Jewish oligarch Viktor Vekselberg, who's on the U.S. sanctions list because of his close relationship with Vladimir Putin. Vekselberg is also a major investor in Israeli high tech. Amazon is bidding on the Jedi Project, the Pentagon's new cloud where top military secrets will be transferred, including classified details about weapon systems, military personnel, operations, and nuclear codes. Amazon has worked closely with C5, a group of cyber investment companies linked to Vekselberg. If Amazon were to win the Jedi contract, Russian and Israeli intelligence would have real-time access to the Pentagon's most sensitive secrets, just like what Israel did with Promise Software, selling it to the Sandia Nuclear Development Laboratory in Los Alamos.
Then Israel wanted to buy it. Israel couldn't afford it at the time. They stole it. Israel took it to Israel, and they realized, why don't we put a back door and peddle it to countries that we are other enemies and so on. But Israel became a vendor, a marketer for that to friendly countries and enemy countries who bought it.
Microsoft is also bidding on the Jedi contract. And shout out to Whitney Webb for her research connecting Microsoft's ties to Israel. Microsoft's cloud security is managed by Adalom, an Israeli company. Its CEO and co-founder, Asaf Rapoport, is a graduate of the Talpiot program, which is the best of Israeli military intelligence. So no matter who wins the contract, Israel will have a back door into the Pentagon's most sensitive secrets. If Microsoft wins, Russia would still have access because they've been trading intelligence with Israel for decades.
The one night that I had the blonde wig on, he mentioned that I looked like, you know, I looked like to, you know, that I reminded him of his daughter. And actually the maid fantasy, I didn't have a blonde wig on. I was trying to stay away from blonde wigs at the time. But he actually requested, told Tiffany that that's what he wanted me to wear. Like, he wanted it. And he's, and anytime I put it on, anytime I had it on and he'd see me, he'd would say, oh man, you look, and just, and it wasn't like a, oh, you remind me of my daughter. It was this sick, evil, like, you remind me of my daughter. It was just this weird pleasure, sick smile. Like, I don't even want to know what he was thinking about. I could imagine what he was thinking about.
Karen McDougal also said Trump told her that she reminded him of his daughter. That's another two women who had affairs with Trump, corroborating Katie Johnson's story. And Trump also tried to pay McDougal after sex, just like he did with Katie Johnson.
But Tiffany promised, ensured me that it wasn't going to be, if it was anything I wasn't comfortable with, we could stop, that she would be right there, and that it wouldn't get out of hand, and that it was a fantasy, like it wasn't really going to happen. I told her that I would. She basically, I mean, Tiffany was always nice to me. She wasn't that I felt, I trusted her, else I, you know, and I wouldn't always trusted her or done what she asked me to, but she was there, and he came in, and I was basically tied to a bed with pantyhose. He tied them, and they were so tight it hurt to even like lay there. And I tried to, you know, try to say something, and it was like, you know, and he just, you know, shut up, you know, shut up, bitch. You know, this is, it was basically like he was being really, really rough. And I understand. It just didn't seem like a fantasy. And I started to get scared, and he was, you know, basically like ripping my clothes off, and I was actually really, I got freaked out. I told him that I didn't want to do this. I was, you know, I screamed over for Tiffany, and you know, she was like, Mr. Trump, and she's only, you know, this is scaring her. And he's like, oh, you shut up too. He just turned into this animal. It was like a completely different person.
Trump's ex-wife, Ivana, also accused them of rape, but later clarified, not in the criminal sense. And I agree with what she's saying. Couples roleplay, Trump went overboard, and she wasn't happy about it. But you can't do that to a 13-year-old. I'm sure there's going to be some people saying it's Katie Johnson's fault. Well, when Muslim grooming gangs take advantage of 13-year-olds in the UK, are they innocent? No. So why would you give a free pass to Donald Trump and Jewish grooming gangs in America who are doing the same thing? That's four women Trump had sexual relations with saying the same things about him, including his ex-wife. Katie Johnson's story checks out. Yes, it is suspicious that she spoke out before the election. I do believe Trump abused her when she was a child. And I also have to look at this realistically. There is a possibility that she wanted to cash in. Johnson dropped her lawsuit against Trump just before she was scheduled to give her first public statement. She would only drop the lawsuit if she was threatened and/or paid off. We know Trump's pit bull, Michael Cohen, was handling these matters.
I was involved in several of these catch and kill episodes.
In part one, I wanted to compare Robert Maxwell to Trump, mainly because even though Maxwell worked for the Mossad and they paid him a lot of money, they still filmed his sexual encounters as an insurance policy in case they ever needed to blackmail him.
Although she does have a very nice figure. I've said that if Ivanka weren't my daughter, perhaps I'd be dating her. You know?
Stop it! Oh, it's so weird! Stop it!
You know what? You are sick.
Isn't that terrible?
Yeah.
Well, terrible?
You're known for saying outrageous things, weird. Mr.
Just
Trump.
Who are you, Woody Allen?
Trump is in the same boat as Maxwell. They know his fantasies, and they will blackmail him if he doesn't do whatever they need him to do. That's why he does whatever they want and PB brags about it. Mike Pompeo and John Bolton are the public faces of Trump's Iran policy, but Sigal Mandelker is actually the one running its most important component. Trump appointed Mandelker, an Israeli citizen, as the Undersecretary of the Treasury for Terrorism and Financial Intelligence. He appointed another Mossad agent, Samantha Ravitch, as Deputy Chair of the President's Intelligence Advisory Board. He appointed another Mossad agent, Steven Feinberg, as Chair of the President's Intelligence Advisory Board. Feinberg also owns DynCorp, which has a long history of pedophilia. Just mentioning this for any Pizzagate people watching who think that DynCorp only donated to Clinton. Just like Maroka said, we'll donate to Clinton, and we'll donate twice as much to the Republicans. Trump eliminated the White House cybersecurity coordinator job and gave the job duties to John Bolton, giving a Mossad asset control of the White House's cybersecurity. Trump appointed Rudy Giuliani, another Mossad asset, as chairman of the President's Cyber Defense Committee, and the central component of his strategy is cooperation with Israel. And that's exactly what's happening here. The Department of Homeland Security gave Morvasek, an Israeli company, the cybersecurity contract to guard financial institutions. But in reality, they're not guarding. They're stealing information and aiding organized crime, just like they did with Promise, Converse, and Amdocs. Trump appointed Ann Neuberger, another Mossad agent, to lead the NSA's new cybersecurity directorate. US agencies are not allowed to use Russian and Chinese cybersecurity software, and rightfully so. But Israel has got caught spying and committing terrorism against the United States and Britain numerous times. Israel needs to be banned as well. But thanks to Trump, Israel now completely controls America's cyber defenses. They have the country kill switched, and if they don't get what they want, they can shut down the critical infrastructure, This is the ultimate form of blackmail. I've just shown you that Trump put six Israeli spies in charge of intelligence and cybersecurity. Now you're going to see Steve Pachinik, with his chutzpah on full display, lie through his teeth saying that Trump is going to indict the Israeli spies in America.
So from 9/11 on, Trump understood that the Israelis had been involved in an intelligence service and in compromising America. He never forgot that. And what he did blatantly was to turn around, and on a certain day, he decided he was going to indict every one of the Mossad operatives, as well as the Israelis, on charges of pedophilia. Not on charges of spying, because that wouldn't work. But Acosta, the Secretary of Labor, was correct when he said that Epstein got off of the prosecutor's indictment in Florida because he worked in the intelligence service. Now, it's not only the Mossad that's involved. Clearly, the CIA was involved, and it was the old CIA and not the present CIA. Why do I say that? Because the heroes of this picture is not only Trump and the White House, but it really involves what I consider to be my deep state, which is what I've talked about for 20 years, the people at the NSA, the NRO, the NGA, the CIA, the new CIA, and other intelligence organizations, which blew this operation apart over the past 10 to 20 years, because in their NSA sweep of our telephones, or the metadata, as they called it, they had picked up Israeli compromises all over the United States and in the world. What we have now is a real problem with Israel. And Israel had been placed on notice because our ambassador, the Jewish ambassador there, as well as Kushner, have made a very clear statement. Israel, you're on notice. If you do not make a peace treaty with the Palestinians, there will be more serious repercussions than you imagine. The beginning of the takedown of your Mossad operatives, who were all present, and we will put them in prison, is just the beginning of what we can do to the future of Israel.
Trump pardoned Jewish neocon Scooter Libby, an architect of the Iraq War, who blew Valerie Plame's cover as a CIA agent after her husband, Joe Wilson, went to Niger and exposed the weapons of mass destruction lie. Scooter Libby is also seen as a pedophile who wrote a fantasy novel about training prepubescent girls to become prostitutes. Interestingly, he also named his book The Apprentice, same name as Trump's reality show. Former Trump advisor George Nader is being charged with child pornography and child sex trafficking. Nader was investigated by Mueller for paying Joel Zammel of Cygroup $2 million. Cygroup is an Israeli intelligence firm which offered to use PSYOPs to get Trump elected. Look, we know who runs Hollywood, and in their movies they like to reference pizza and pedophilia scenes. But Pizzagate was a PSYOP to get Trump elected, saying you have to vote for Trump because Hillary is surrounded by pedophiles. But in reality, Trump is surrounded by even more pedophiles. In these last two videos, I've shown you 9 cases of Trump's ties to pedophilia. Both Trump and Bill Clinton are compromised pedophiles. A lot of the disinfo agents and alternative media are saying leave Trump alone and focus on someone less relevant like Bill Clinton, who hasn't been president in 18 years and is probably going to die soon. As you've just seen in this series, Trump's ties to Epstein reveal so much about how Israel has taken over America through espionage, but the shills want you to ignore this and continue arguing about left versus right, Republican versus Democrat, when both sides are controlled